And have a quick review of what we've done so far in our homework, our assignments.
It was due today.
Sorry?
I thought it was due today, so I apologise, I haven't sent it.
I'm just checking where I am. Sorry, you thought I said Monday?
Yes, in the last year.
For the second, the revision Friday. Revelation 10 and 14 today.
Okay, so who wants? I presume you've got your documents in front of you. Who wants to have a go at explaining?
Which one are you referencing?
Number 2. Is everybody reasonably happy with number 1, the revisions? Yeah? Yeah, I had a look at I've read them all. Most of them there weren't any substantial changes. They were just sort of tweaked a little bit. So I was expecting a bit more of a change from most of them. But they were very minor changes. Just one thing. When you're submitting your documents via email, could you please ensure that they're in Word format, not PDF? Mm. And I know not everybody has a computer, so I think some people are doing it via text message, which I guess I'll have to try and sort of get around. But could you just label them in a way that's meaningful to me as opposed to like homework or something? Because when I'm getting 12 documents, it gets a bit hard keeping the track of what's going on. So if you can just sort of say assignment 2 or revision of assignment 1 or something like that, something that's I can understand what's going on. So who should we go with? Brother Mario, did you submit an assignment?
The second one?
Yeah.
Not yet.
Not yet. Okay, that's why I don't have it. I thought I was sticking, I didn't have it. Brother Jonathan.
Yes.
So, explain how. What are we asking to do? What's the question?
How I understood it is, why is the mighty angel of Revelation 10 the same as the first angel?
Yeah, is that everybody's understanding? To demonstrate that the angel of Revelation 10 is the first angel.
Yes.
Yeah. So, how did you go about doing that?
I started making a list. On one side, I did Revelation 14, 6, and 7. I showed the characteristics of that angel. On the other side, Revelation 10.
Mm-hmm.
And I showed what they have in common, what is a repetition, what is, for me, an enlargement.
Okay, go with the repetition. Just
For example, the Revelation 14 angels is flying in the heaven. And the Revelation 10 angel is coming down from heaven, so he needs to fly as well.
He needs to come down, so he's flying beforehand.
Yeah, if he comes down, he's flying. Isn't that...
Do you like that, Sister Olivine? Take that as a no. I don't know.
It's a worldwide message.
What are you laughing for? Worldwide.
Yes.
And this is?
Worldwide.
Worldwide.
The angel of Revelation 14 is saying with a loud voice. The other one is crying with a loud voice.
Okay, loud voice.
Yeah, loud voice, yeah.
Sister Tess, loud voice?
Yeah.
Is that a good thing to lock it in?
That's clear.
both of them are really kind.
So it's, what about if we went to Revelation 18 verse 2? Because of the strong voice. Sorry?
No, I was just trying to remember if the word strong here is similar to the word loud. It's just the same word.
Is it the same? I don't know. Have a quick look. Okay, someone can find that. Carry on. Which one's loud voice?
Both.
Loud, did you say, they both say loud voice? Okay.
This is loud voice.
Sorry, that says loud voice? And that says loud voice as well?
Yeah.
Same word.
Okay. Strong is the same? Okay, so Revelation 18 verse 2 says it as well.
Strong voice.
Yeah.
And he cried mightily with a strong voice.
Yeah. So it's the same, apparently it's the same Greek word. So that would be the second, wouldn't it? Okay.
Both mentioned the Creator, like worship him that made heaven, earth and sea.
Okay, so creation.
Yeah, that was, that's the thing they have in common. I don't know if there's more, I didn't see.
Okay, they're the ones that you saw.
Yeah.
Both of them have to deal with time. One says the hour of his judgment is come, one says time shall be no longer.
Can you do that just because they both talk about time?
Sorry.
Just because they, but one says, but they're totally different times, aren't they?
Yeah. But just the similarity that they're dealing with time aspect. It's different, but it's.
Do we agree with that? Do you agree with that, Brother Jonathan?
Sorry, I.
He says the hour of his judgment, because he says hour, that's time, and it says time should be no longer.
That's different, although they're talking maybe about the same event.
Okay. Anyone else got anything? He hasn't gotten to the spirit of prophecy quotes yet. How has anybody else done it? I'm not saying in this exact same way, but any other parallels or?
Open book. First angel arrives and then book is open, and here the angel has a book open in his hand. Says it was to be sealed until the book was to be sealed until the time of the end. And here this angel has an open book. So
they both got open books?
Well, the open book is common.
So that's what I'm saying. So you're saying yes, he's got an open book and he's got an open book?
Yes.
Brother Jonathan?
What I did, I just compared the text. I just compared Revelation 14:6 with Revelation 10. Revelation 14:6 and 7, you don't see that the angel has a book in his hand. So that was for me enlargement. Or it's not a repetition because we don't see it in Revelation 14:6. It's a further information.
So all he's done is just gone to the Bible verses because you're going to other information.
Mm-hmm.
From the Bible, anything else that you can see? Do we all agree with this one? One's in heaven and one's coming down.
I
agree. No? Is it the test?
What do you mean by in heaven?
This one's an angel's flying in heaven, and this one is an angel's coming down.
For me, they're in different positions, so I don't see. Mm-hmm.
Brother Jonathan's argument was that's the earth, and he's flying in heaven. He must have come down from heaven.
Revelation 10.
Yeah, he says because he's come down to earth, he must have been coming from heaven. That was his argument. No?
We have him circling the globe, he could have just come straight down and then he hasn't had to fly. Sounds silly, but you can just come straight.
Okay, this really?
he's got the everlasting gospel. He's in the, the 14:6 angel has the everlasting gospel. He's in the midst of heaven. And then kind of echoing test, it seems to make sense to me as well that he just comes down to deliver the message rather than having a vision appear to John.
In verse 2.
I don't think she said that. You said you're echoing her.
Can you speak up a little bit?
So you said you echoed what she said.
I added the vision component to it.
No, but even before that, she's saying it's not the same thing.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Jonathan's saying it is.
Okay, well then, I'm agreeing with Jonathan. Where I can see that it could be the same angel.
But how do you know where he's come from?
Because it says, comes down from heaven.
He said, lift up his hand to heaven. So he can't be in heaven if he's lifting. In verse 10:5.
10:1. I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven. So is that what you're saying? Yes.
I couldn't pay attention to this one. The AC is too loud. What did you say?
It says he came down from heaven in 10:1.
The only thing I'm saying, but if it's not the same, I don't mind, is the process in coming down. He needs to fly. He's flying down to heaven.
Yeah, all I'm saying is he says he's flying in the midst of heaven, I think.
Uh-huh.
And here it says he's flying down from heaven.
Yeah. So my point is that they both fly wherever they fly to. But if it's different, I don't mind. It's different.
Why don't you go with that, Sister Tess?
I can go with that. Kind of flexible.
Okay. Sister Olivier? No, what? You laughed at first.
I laughed because he just called on me suddenly, not because of what he said.
Okay. So he's in heaven and he comes down from heaven. I think that's what Jonathan's saying. And he's got a worldwide message. He's got a worldwide message. He speaks with a loud voice. He speaks with a loud voice. He speaks about creation. He speaks about creation. Is that
what I'm supposed to be doing, comparing the two? Is that what the assignment was?
Well, it depends how good you want to do the job, I guess. Don't take that seriously. That's the way he did it. I only just picked someone. He did it that way. No one else did it that way.
Mario did.
I don't know what Mario did. Mario didn't give me his assignment, so I don't know what he did. He just typed that out now from the board.
No.
I saw him typing it.
My number 4 was proclaiming time.
Nope, you're going to get an F now. Copying. So, okay, so it says strong voice here, but there's lots of associations here. So I'll take that one out because that's a...
Do we have grades for our last assignment?
Sorry?
Do we have grades, Mark?
No, I'm forbidden to give grades, apparently.
Okay. If you were...
This is true education, something like that. So we don't do grades unless you fail. Anyone else? Okay, so do you think that's a good way of approaching it? Yeah? Yeah?
Mark has that proved it's the first angel?
Sorry? Brother Luke.
Mm-hmm.
Well, how does that prove it's the first angel?
What's talking about the same things?
Okay, yeah.
Okay, it's that simple. I thought it was something more profound that you're looking for. It's just talking about the same thing. I could have done that one. Is that what you're asking?
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, he's talking about the same thing. I thought it was something. Okay, if it is so, why didn't anybody else do this?
I used most of the same quotes from the previous study assignment.
Oh yeah, the spirit prophecy quotes. No, he's gone to Word Association.
Bible, yeah.
So that's not all he did, but that's his initial premise. So let's look at the words. Is that what we're supposed to do?
Yes, we are.
Yeah? So I thought that was a really good way of starting off.
Amen.
Yeah? Amen. Okay, so he did that. This was all 10:1. Is it all 10:1? No, it's not all 10:1.
No.
1, 2. All of this is in the... Okay, so it's not like the two verses or something.
No, it's
I was looking at the whole chapter of Revelation 10.
Okay, but where does all these 4 points come in?
The first is verse 1.
That's 1. Worldwide.
The creation is... The worldwide is...
In any order you want.
Creation is 6.
11.
The worldwide is 11?
Yeah.
And loud voice?
The loud voice is...
Verse 3.
Is that everything? 1, 3, 6, 11.
Might be more.
Yeah, I like that. Anyone else with the Bible verses? Without the Spirit of Prophecy quotes? Brother Luke.
I use the loud voice, I think.
The same one, you use the same logic?
Yeah.
I mean, anything different? Brother Mary?
Yeah. I pretty much had the same comparison. Actually, I had 4, but we just disqualified the time aspect. So
okay.
It's 3.
So you had 5, because we got 4 already.
So it's... They both have a special message to proclaim. That's a worldwide message.
Worldwide?
They both utter their proclamation with a loud voice.
Yeah, tell me if it's different, not the same.
No. Very same. Yeah.
No, tell me something different to what Jonathan's put up.
Oh.
That's what I mean.
Oh, no, I don't.
Okay.
It's the same thing.
Okay, so Brother Jonathan did the same thing, and then what did you do?
I made it with colors. This was green, and then I did a color with the part which is enlarges to Revelation 14.
Oh, yeah, with the color. I couldn't read the different colors. It needs to be really contrasted.
Oh, okay.
For me. But anyway, that was just...
I showed that we have in Revelation 10, the angel, we have a description of the angel, like clothed with a cloud, rainbow upon his head, face as sun, feet as pillars. That was an enlargement for me. It shows
okay,
how
so
the angel is looks like.
Angel as well.
Sorry?
The same angel.
How do you know it's the same angel?
Because Sister White says it.
Well, that's the whole, that's what
oh,
the assignment is, isn't it? The assignment is to know that it's the same angel. So he just
right,
goes through
okay.
the Bible verse first.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So it's the description.
Yeah.
So the description and is. So what's this angel got? Does it say anything about this angel?
Yes, having everlasting counsel.
Like a description of him, though.
No.
It doesn't give any information. And this one gives a lot of information.
Yes.
Okay. So we won't list them out, but there's a number of them. What else?
The Revelation 10 angel has a little open book in his hand.
Okay, so there's this book, and there's nothing here.
No.
Anything else?
7 thunders are sealed up.
He speaks.
Mm-hmm.
And he speaks as well, yeah?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So he speaks the gospel. And what does he say?
Thunders.
So does he speak the 7 thunders?
No.
The angel.
It's 4 and then 7 thunders.
Yeah,
like
10. The 7 thunders.
Yes. Yeah, I'm asking, does he speak it?
I think what he said is a consequence. The 7 thunders is a consequence of what he said. My thoughts.
The 7 thunders are a so who's saying the 7 thunders then?
He is.
But she's saying he's not, so I was asking her.
I don't know.
But it's someone else.
I would think so.
Okay, so you think it's someone else. It's the Shemilla, you're saying it's the same, it's the angel or someone else?
I think it's someone else.
Someone else, someone, Brother Jonathan?
If the verse says, after he had, and when he had cried, 7 thunders uttered their voices. Seems to me like it's someone else.
Sister Olivine?
And then, like, I can use the quotation that we have.
Okay, so before the quotation, just the verse itself, is it the same person? Yeah. How do you show it's the same person? Just using the verse.
And when he had.
Which verse are we in?
Verse 3.
I think it's the same actually.
And when he had cried.
Have you changed your mind?
The yes, seven thunders.
Yeah,
because
it's the same.
It says
he cried twice.
Where does it say he cried twice?
No, verse 3.
And
then he had cried seven thunders.
As when a lion roared, and when he had cried, so that's the same person crying.
And the principle that you had given us with the colon.
But this wouldn't make the angel the seven thunders.
I'm not saying the angel is the seven thunders. I say that it's his voice.
Yeah.
But how do you read that from that verse? Okay,
so what do we know for sure? It says, and he cried with a loud voice as when a lion roareth. So we know that, yeah? So when he speaks, he sounds like what?
Lion.
Sounds like a lion. And then what happens? And when he had cried like a lion, seven thunders uttered their voices.
This sounds to me like he stops crying, and then you hear the seven thunders saying something.
So he speaks, then the seven thunders speak. Yeah?
He's the same one that
speaks. So let's just do verse 4. And when the seven thunders had uttered their voices, that's in the plural, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
I was about to write, and I heard a voice from heaven. So there's another voice.
Yes.
Is that the angel?
No.
So there's another voice. Says, don't write.
Saying, seal up.
So there seems to be three different people speaking. The angel, the seven thunders, and another voice. Do we all agree with that?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Was there anything else that you picked up before we put a spirit prophecy quote to try and address that?
Yeah, then in then this angel says time is no longer in verse.
So he speaks once, and then he speaks again.
Yeah. And this angel tells John to eat the little book. And it's going to be sweet and bitter. And he says to John again that he had to prophesy once again.
Say.
There's another speaking. Oh.
That's what I have.
Say.
Oh.
Is there? Yeah.
That's a voice from heaven that speaks again.
This one? Another voice says, don't write.
Yes, and then they speak again. And the voice which I heard from heaven spake unto me again. So they speak again is the voice which he had heard from heaven.
Which verse?
Verse 8.
The other things. Okay, so this isn't the angel.
No.
This is the one from heaven.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And eat little book is who? Angel?
This it, no. That same voice which speak again.
This is from heaven as well?
Yeah.
And this one prophesy again?
That's the angel.
So the angel doesn't tell John?
No, that's not correct.
No?
In verse 9 it says, and I went unto the angel and said unto him, give me the little book, and he said unto me, take it and eat
that's
it up.
That's the angel. The angel said, he said unto me.
But it's heaven. He wrote heaven at number 3.
No, not there. In verse 8, and the voice which I heard from heaven spake unto me again and say, go and take the little book.
Yep. And then read verse 9. And in verse 9 it said, and he said unto me. Who is the he? Is it the angel?
Yes.
Can we take this book, which is open in the hand of the angel?
Fine.
So it says, who says this one? Do we all agree heaven. That's heaven?
Yeah. Second one, heaven too.
What verse is that?
Verse 8.
This is verse 6?
Verse 8, and the voice which I had heard from heaven spake unto me again. Verse 8.
But I think we are talking about the time, right? What were you asking?
The time.
Yeah, that's verse 6.
Oh.
That's verse 6?
Yes.
Who's saying that?
The angel.
So this is the angel, not heaven then? Mm.
It's the angel.
The angel says this one. This is verse 6. In verse 7, we're in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God shall be finished, as he hath declared in his servants' prophets. So that's the same person speaking, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now we're in verse 8. Now what's happening?
Voice from heaven speaking again.
So the voice from heaven says,
take the little book.
Is that all it says? Take the book.
From the angel.
Didn't tell you what to do with it?
Verse 9 is, I thought it was the angel. Jonathan says it's the voice from heaven.
No.
And
I'm saying it's the angel.
Yes.
And I went unto the angel and said unto him, the angel,
yes,
give me the little book. And he said unto me, who's the he?
The angel.
The angel.
So we all agree it's the angel.
Yeah.
So this one, now it's the angel. He says, eat the book. Take it and eat it up, and it shall make thy belly bitter, but it shall be in thy mouth sweet as honey. Took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it, and it was as he said it was. Mm-hmm. And he said unto me, thou must prophesy again before many peoples. Who's the he?
The angel.
So then the angel speaks again. It says, prophesy again. Is that all you got through all the verses? Okay, so let's do this one then, because we've got three people speaking. Spirit prophecy quote, you said. Find it, or
I'm just reading it over.
We'll go with the reference so we could read it over as well.
I'm reading 7 MR 971 paragraph 4.
971?
Yes.
Is that 17 MR?
7. Sorry, 7 BC.
7 BC.
Mm-hmm.
971.4. Let's read that. And you think this is going to tell us what?
That's why I was reading it over.
I'll After these seven thunders utter their voices, the injunction comes to John as to Daniel in regard to the little book. Seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered. These relate to future events which shall be disclosed in the order. Daniel shall stand in his lot at the end of the days. John sees the little book unsealed. Then Daniel's prophecies have their proper place in the first, second, and third angel's messages to be given to the world. The unsealing of the little book was the message in relation to time. Okay, you see if you can find something on that. Let's go to some spirit prophecy quotes now. Someone else. Just the test. Some spirit prophecy quotes to show that these angels are the same angel.
MIR 18:42.
Maranatha. 18:18:2. Did everybody have this one?
Yeah, but mine's from a different quote.
But it's the same quote?
Yes.
Which one?
If you give us the original one then.
2SM 107.3. Mm-hmm. 108.1. But this one in Maranatha is cut off. From the end, it says message of warning, but the original says message of warning to our world.
Okay. Second selected message 107.3. Is that what you got? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And 108.1.
Second selected message is 103.
107.3.
When we do referencing, if you try and make the effort to at least go back to the original one as opposed to compilations, just so that we're all kind of trying to be on the same page, unless it's not that straightforward. The message of Revelation 14 proclaiming that the hour of God's judgment is come is given in the time of the end. The angel of Revelation 10 is represented as having one foot on the sea and one foot on the land, showing that the message will be carried to distant lands. The ocean will be crossed and the islands of the sea will hear the proclamation of the last message of warning to our world. Did everybody use this quote?
Yes.
Everybody? Yeah?
And the following as well.
And the following paragraph?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, so Sister Tess, why is this a proof text?
She's describing them both as having the same message in context.
Just run the word through.
The message of Revelation 14 is proclaiming that the hour of God's judgment is to come.
Okay.
And then she switches to the angel of Revelation 10, so it's the same thought, the same message. She's just drawing like a repeat in large.
Mm-hmm. Everybody agree with that? Is that the logic that everybody used?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it says the message of 14 is given in the time of the end, run on sentence. And the angel of Revelation 10 is showing what?
The worldwide proclamation.
It's showing that the message,
yes,
is now going to go worldwide.
Yes.
Yeah? Brother Jonathan?
How do I know? I'm missing a part. How do I know that the message of Revelation 14 is the first angel? Why is it not mentioned the second angel? Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
My answer to that, do you want me to give the answer?
Yep. Oh, is there anybody else? Has anybody got an answer?
It says, the message of Revelation 14, there are three angels. How do I know it's not the second or the third?
Because it references the hour.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The time is come.
Yeah. Proclaiming that the hour of God's judgment is come.
So this says, the message of 14 is in the time of the end,
yeah,
and then it says
proclaiming
God's judgment has come,
and the same message is given in 10. I've paraphrased that obviously badly, but is that what it's saying?
Yes.
And so the question is, how do you know it's the first angel in 14? And it says because of the phrase that comes after it.
Yes.
The hour of his judgment is come. Which is verse
14:6.
Yeah? Six. Six or seven?
Six.
Nope.
And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven having the everlasting gospel to preach. Six. Seven.
Seven?
Seven.
Fear God and give glory to him for the hour of his judgment has come.
Okay, so it's seven, yes?
Yes.
Six or seven.
I have just a minor additional point. It says, this message goes to the islands of the sea, which I just looked if I find something else, and then you see that the first angel's message in Gospel Work is 470, paragraph 2, also goes to the island of the seas.
So, Gospel Workers?
470, paragraph 2.
70?
470, yeah, paragraph 2.
So read that.
The time has come when, through God's messengers, the scroll is being unrolled to the world.
Speak a little bit slower, please.
Okay, the time has come when, through God's messengers, the scroll is being unrolled to the world. The truth contained in the first, second, and third angels' messages must go to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. It must lighten the darkness of every continent and extend to the islands of the seas. And we see the islands of the seas also in the first quote.
And what does that do?
Just shows that this first angel's message is worldwide. It even goes to the island of the sea. It's just another characteristic,
okay.
Maybe. Just an additional point. Minor point.
That's what he said to SM as well. Islands of the sea.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what he said.
Yep.
He's gone from 2SM, picked that phrase up and found it in Gospel Workers.
Mm-hmm.
So you wanted to do the next paragraph, and the angel which I saw stand upon the sea and upon the earth lift up his hand. So he's going to quote verses 5 and 6. This message announces the end of the prophetic periods. The disappointment of those who expected to see our Lord in 1844 was indeed bitter to those who had so ardently looked for his appearing. It was in the Lord's order that this disappointment should come and that hearts should be revealed. So, what are you saying that says?
It's just elaborating on Revelation 10. That's the only reason I continued and used the second, the following
so
paragraph.
It says this message.
Mm-hmm.
What
yeah.
is this message in this paragraph now?
The,
is it the same message in the first paragraph?
It's talking about, so this message would be Revelation 10, 5 and 6, which is also the same as Revelation 14 in the preceding paragraph. So I read it.
Revelation 14, verse 6?
Yes, so when we just highlighted 14, 6 and 7 is speaking of the hour of God's judgment is come, in the time of the end, and then at the angel of Revelation 10 is also the same it's the same message but on a broader scale. It's just, so it's the arrival and the empowerment. That's how I see it.
Is that how everybody's reading that? Well, it says this message.
The first thing.
Sister Sarah, is that how you read it? She said that verses 5 and 6 go back to Revelation 14, verse 6. So this message is the message of Revelation 14, verse 6. So this message here in this second paragraph is the same message in the first paragraph. You say no? What is the message in paragraph 1?
It is
14, 6?
Yeah, it's the God's judgment.
And what's the message in paragraph 2?
Time's no longer.
It's the right one. They're disagreeing with you. They're saying this message is not Revelation 14:6. The message that she's referring to is just that last bit, that there should be time no longer.
I don't know. I can't change their mind, but I believe that that's how I'm reading it, because
you've got to defend your position. You can't say I can't change their mind.
I'm saying that so 107.3 says that those two are one in the same. It says a message of Revelation 14, 6 and 7. That's where it talks about God's judgment. And then it says immediately after, and the angel of Revelation 10, that's how I'm reading it, that the angel of Revelation 10 is the angel of Revelation 14. That's how I read it.
No, one gives us that information. The question is, when it says the message, I'm asking what that message is. So Sister Sarah's saying, the message is, time shall be no longer. Which is a separate message. That's all she's saying.
That's the end of prophetic periods. Wouldn't that be... So I see that as I don't know exactly what the end of prophetic periods could be, but I don't want to guess at it either. So I would say 1798.
What is 1798?
The end of the prophetic periods, and that would also be in line with the previous paragraph where it says time of the end. So the end of prophetic periods is the time of the end.
If we did a study of prophetic periods, it would take us 677, 457, and 508. And all these would take you to where? Okay, so we'll put 1843 just to be use the same understanding as the Millerite. So these would be the prophetic periods.
Mm-hmm. What about the, how do you know isn't that based on the 2300? What about the 2520? It could
that
be
is,
1719.
That is the 2520. That's the 2300 date. Sorry, that's one of them.
Yeah, the other one is 723.
But when it says this message announces the end of the prophetic periods, the end of the prophetic periods isn't 1798, is it?
She goes on to say the disappointment of those who expected to see our Lord in 1844 is indeed bitter, and so on. Okay, yep, I accept that.
Brother Jonathan?
I think in the first paragraph of 107, paragraph 3, it talks about that both messages, 14 and 10, are worldwide. And in the second paragraph, I think the message is time is no longer. So that's why I think this message refers to Revelation 10, 5, and 6.
This 7 BC 971, paragraph 4, the last sentence says this unsealing of the little book was a message in relation to time.
It says it in 7 and 8 as well, paragraph.
So what does that mean?
If the unsealing of the little book was a message in relation to time, that means the first angel's message is a message relating to time.
Okay.
And therefore, the Revelation 10's message is dealing with time. It is announcing time is no longer. And it is announcing the time, the difference with what Sharmila says. The first angel's message is to arrive at the time of the end. So it's the first angel's message is not the time of the end, but it arrives at the time of the end. And it is a message in relation to time. And also in early writings, Ellen White.
Before you go to early writing, are you agreeing with Sister Shamela or disagreeing with her?
I'm agreeing with her that it is the same message.
Okay, so when it says the message in paragraph 2, it's the same message as paragraph 1.
Yes, because they are the same. It's the same angel, just repeating and enlarging.
Yes.
You can't do that because you already agreed with him. You backed down too quickly before you got to the other being help.
What did I agree with?
Okay, don't worry. So, develop your argument so that Brother Jonathan can get it, then he can say you're wrong.
Sorry, I thought you were reading 7 BC 971 to prove that the angel speaks the seven thunders.
No,
she's given up that one.
Yes, I did.
So, because this question is still not answered in my mind. So is it correct, was on the board?
The three at the moment, yeah.
So the angel is not speaking the seven thunders?
I am not backing down from that. I just haven't...
You can't prove it.
Okay.
But
so
I was dealing...
That's not any longer our point.
No, you were talking about this...
Yes, that's no longer the point.
Remember that we had gone on to second SM 107.4,
108.1. Yeah, he's confused because you took us back to the same paragraph.
Yeah, and I read the last sentence.
Yeah, but he thought you're going back to this issue, but
no,
you're not.
No.
So you're coming back to this issue.
Yes.
So what's your argument now?
That the message, she says the unsealing of the little book was the message in relation to time.
Okay.
So therefore, the first, second, and third angel's messages are the first angel's message, which... arrived at the time of the end when knowledge shall be increased, is a message relating to time.
Okay. Did everybody get that?
Repeat.
Okay, so people aren't understanding that. You need to go a bit slower. Let's go to, we're in 1798, at the time of the end. What's this angel saying now?
It's announcing the of God's judgment.
Okay, so I know that, but
it's based on time.
So he's saying he's going to speak a message about time.
Yes.
Do we all agree with that?
How do I know that he speaks a message about time?
How do you know that?
The unsealing of the little book was a message in relation to time.
Okay, so let me ask a different question. When is the message unsealed?
At the time of the end.
The time of the end is the book of Daniel unsealed.
Okay, so we've got unsealed. We've got a reference of that?
The famous L. White quote.
TM 115.
So we're going to put TM 115, paragraph 3. But we've got a Bible verse?
Daniel 12:4
says,
"Time of the end, the book of Daniel is sealed until the time of the end."
Okay, so it's Daniel 12:4. Anything else? Another one? Francis
Nisha? That's the one I had in mind.
Okay, so we'll go with that one. Daniel 12:4. Now the book begins to be unsealed. So now we've got the unsealing. Now what you're saying?
It says the unsealing of the little book was the message in relation to time.
Okay, so the unsealing is a message about time. So whatever the first angel's doing, we've already proven that the first angel comes here in 1798. That was assignment one. We all agree with that.
Mm-hmm.
And when he comes, he's going to give a message that's about time. Yeah?
That's what...
Do we all agree with that's what his message is?
Yes.
And so what is he saying about time?
Time is no longer.
No, he's not saying time is no longer, is he here?
He's saying the
or is he saying that?
He's saying the hour of judgment is come.
Okay, so it's a message about time, mm-hmm. And what is it about time? That it's... Sorry? It's time for judgment.
Yes.
Can we say it that way?
Yes.
And when is the judgment?
He gives a specific time.
So he's speaking here. When is the judgment?
1844.
1844? Is that, we all agree with that?
Yeah.
Is come, it says.
Should we put 1843?
Is come.
Either way, I don't mind 1843-44. I'm not making that. I just said it for one argument. So
no, I just wanted to know if you wanted us to be as...
No, that was okay. That was just to show that the reason I did that is because 508 won't take you to 1844. It won't do that. So that's why I put 43 there. Because people, if I put 44, people would say that's error.
Could you use 1335 as well?
Sorry?
1335.
That's
okay. Yeah, that is. That's what I mean. That's why I'm saying it won't go to 44.
Yeah. Right.
Bring you to the cusp of 44. So when it says it's time for judgment, when is that time? In 1844? It's time for judgment in 44. We can say that?
Yeah.
Do we agree with that? So he speaks a message about time and he says it's time for the judgment in 44. Okay? And this is Daniel 8:14. So he's going to give that message. So now carry on your point.
So therefore he's telling, as I said, that he's announcing if it is a message relating to time, and the Revelation 10 is saying time shall be no longer.
Okay, you're reading from 7 BC 971.
Mm-hmm.
Have you finished with that one?
Yes. I just wanted the last sentence.
Paragraph 4, the unsealing of the little book was the message in relation to time. So when it says the message, what is this message? When it says the message, it's first the first angel's message.
In paragraph 7, she goes on to say, this time which the angel declares with a solemn oath is not the end of this world's history, neither of a probationary time, but of a prophetic time. We should precede the advent of our Lord.
So, okay, so let's go down to 7. We'll read that again.
Yeah.
This time, where is it? Where are we picking up this time from?
She's now jumping back to Revelation 10.
Where are you reading from?
She's where?
7 BC.
7 BC.
971.7.
We're in paragraph 7. It says, this time.
Mm-hmm.
So what time is she referring to in this paragraph? Back.
She's going back to the first angel, but she's now tying it in with the second, with the Revelation 10.
No, I'm just saying, in the paragraphs itself, where does it say this time? Which time is she referring to?
Oh, the time of 971.4.
The unsealing of the little book was the message in relation to time. Is that the only place she's going to talk about time as we go further back? Because the section begins in 3.
Yes.
Then we've got to 4, it says...
Yes.
So this is the first time time's introduced?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Then...
Well, the time of the end,
No, it's the first time is here introduced. The rest of it is not dealing with time. She says, the special light given to John, which was expressed in the seven thunders, was a delineation of events transpiring under the first, second, and second angel's messages. It was not. So then she goes now, she's going back to the time of paragraph 4.
So when it says time, it's not talking about he's come here on time. It's talking about the time here, isn't it?
Yes.
The time that they're in, not this one.
No.
Yeah?
So that's not the time of the end where it says...
I see time again.
You see time?
Where?
Which paragraph are you in?
971.6. The last sentence.
Okay.
This is represented by the angel standing with one foot on the sea, proclaiming with the most solemn oath that time should be no longer.
Okay, so we've read verse 4, so let's go to verse 5 then. The books of Daniel Revelation are one is a prophecy, the other a revelation, one a book sealed, the other book opened. John heard the mysteries which the thunders uttered, but he was commanded not to write them. So some people picked this up in assignment 1 and some people didn't. But you all read everybody's one, and I was hoping everybody would put this into their assignment. This paragraph here. Why is this paragraph important? I can't remember who did it.
Because it's highlighting that they are one. And same like Jonathan said, repeating and enlarging. One is a book open, one is a book closed. So one is a commentary.
Okay, but somebody said it quite specifically. The book of Daniel has been sealed. Okay, now you need to unseal Daniel. You don't unseal Daniel by getting light on Daniel.
No.
How do you unseal Daniel?
By
the revelation. The revelation unseals it.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's something specific in the revelation that unseals Daniel. And that is what? What is the specific thing that unseals Daniel? Where's the unsealing happening? Which chapter?
14.
14, and 14 is what?
3 in his message.
Yeah? Or if you just went to 1, it's the
everlasting gospel.
So it's the everlasting gospel that unseals the book of Daniel.
Amen.
Yeah? So what we did this morning about a reform line, which is the gospel, it's all about prophecy. If you want to understand prophecy, the tool that you use, or the key, is the gospel. The gospel is what unlocks or decodes prophecy. Yes?
Mm-hmm.
So, has all of the book of Daniel been unsealed?
Mm-hmm.
Tanisha, my sister? Has all of the book of Daniel been unsealed?
It's in the process.
When does the unsealing occur?
When did it begin?
Go on then. Okay, does the Bible say it's being unsealed? It says it's unsealed.
Unsealed.
It's sealed till the time of the end, therefore at the time of the end it's unsealed.
Yes.
Yeah? So if you want to put progression in there, I don't mind, I'm okay to do that. But when does it happen?
Time of the end.
So are we past the time of the end? So has the book of Daniel been unsealed?
Yes.
Yeah? So if we were living in 1987, had the book of Daniel been unsealed?
No.
A portion of it had.
No.
Yeah? That portion, whatever it had been unsealed, and what was that? Sorry? What had been unsealed by 1987? Daniel 8, hadn't it? Daniel 8 had been unsealed right back here.
Yeah.
So what's left to be unsealed? Daniel 11 is left to be unsealed. Okay? So how are you going to unseal Daniel 11?
By revelation. Yes.
Okay, what specifically do you have to use in Revelation to unseal it? You have to use the everlasting gospel to do that.
Sorry. Beginner's question, why do we need the three angels' message specifically, or the gospel, to unlock Daniel? I understand that in Revelation we see Daniel unsealed. Why specifically, or maybe I just don't get the connection at the moment.
Okay, but you agree it's something in the Revelation, yeah, that's going to unseal it. So the question is, you go to those 22 chapters, and you've got to work out, where do you unseal Daniel? So, you can go to Millerite history for sure to do that, can't you? Because Millerite history shows you it's Revelation 14.
Okay.
And it's Daniel 8. So you can just see it there.
Okay.
In an obvious way. How could you see it in as a concept or a principle? Or as a theme? Why would he need the gospel to unlock prophecy, as opposed to something else?
Because it's the same, maybe?
How does that answer it? Because it could be any word in Revelation.
But the word was made flesh.
So that would mean it'd be Revelation 1, because here you see Christ. You see.
I don't know. Yeah, but that was just, in my mind, the logical follows your statement.
So that would mitigate against it being the gospel, because that's in 14, the gospel is, and you see Christ in 1.
I don't think I'm following how you're sequencing.
Do you understand my question?
Maybe not.
So my question is, we know that the revelation is what opens or unlocks Daniel.
Yes.
So which part of the revelation would unlock it? We have a lot of circumstantial evidence from all that we've done here, is that we know Daniel is unsealed here in 1798,
okay.
And we know that an angel that holds the everlasting gospel is the person who comes down.
And I have an answer to that.
And he unseals it.
Yes.
So we know that in Millerite history that's what happens. It's 14 that does the unsealing. So my question is, why would it be the gospel that has the unsealing and not a revelation of Christ or a Maria vision or however way you want to look at it, or the trumpets? Why is it the gospel that does the unsealing?
It's the same gospel that was declared in Eden when God said to the serpent, "I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." Genesis 3:15. Here was the first promise of a Savior who would stand on the field of battle to contest the powers of Satan and prevail against him. Christ came to our world to represent the character of God as it is represented in his holy law. For his law is a transcript of his character. Christ was both the law and the gospel. The angel that proclaims the everlasting gospel proclaims the law of God. For the gospel of salvation brings men to obedience of the law, whereby their characters are formed after divine similitude.
Does that answer it?
Maybe it was just too fast and I couldn't follow everything.
Sister Olivine.
It's the same thing that we did last week with proving the arrival of the first angel's message at the time of the end. You're asking, it's the same thing that is being brought. Once we get the concept of why the first angel message arrives at the time of the end, it is the same thing that will give us the answer as to why is it that it is the everlasting gospel or the first, second, and third angel's messages that unseals the book of Daniel. Also, to me, it is similar like the seals and the churches.
Before you do that, before you go to also, explain conceptually why. Why is it the gospel is what is required to unseal prophecy? Not anything else, not any other type of information. Because the trumpets aren't going to unseal it.
No, they can't.
So why is it only the gospel can do the unsealing?
Because it's Christ. As we are proving that, as we were bringing out, the mighty angel is no less a personage than Christ. And it is Christ that... I don't know how to...
It's the lion of the tribe of Judah that prevailed to take the book and to open and loose the seals thereof. So it is the Christ...
No.
Prevailing.
Genesis.
So then you're going to say
he's prevailing.
That's where she went. That you're going to say you have to go to Revelation 5 to do that work.
No, and but he prevailed as the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. Because when John looked, he saw a lamb as it had been slain, and that's the everlasting gospel.
Brother Larry, then Brother Nathan. You haven't said that here today. Brother Larry.
Yeah, if I'm understanding this correctly, the first, second, and third angel's message unlocked the book of Daniel because of what it specifically speaks about. Judgment of sin, righteousness, and judgment. That's what those individuals experienced all through that history. Sin, righteousness, and judgment, which led them to 1844. So that history of Revelation 14 unlocked Daniel 8. Is that correct?
Okay.
So then in my mind, Daniel 11 will be unlocked in similar manner. As we are now repeating the history of the first, second, third angel's message, that history of Daniel 11 will be unlocked to us. If that makes sense.
Yep. Brother Nathan?
Well, we define the everlasting gospel as the work of Christ in developing and then demonstrating two classes of worshipers based upon a three-step prophetic message. And then we understand prophecy to be, a delineation of events leading down to the closed door. So similar to, I agree with what Larry said, that as the everlasting gospel is unsealed to the people, they're understanding that it's a testing message. It's a message that's separating two classes of worshipers, and that's helping them understand where they are in prophetic history. That leads them to the closed door.
Is this a test?
I understand that that might be the journey that you go on while Daniel is being or has been unsealed, but I don't see how that is what unlocks Daniel, because I don't read anywhere that Miller studied Revelation 14 and then studied Daniel. That wasn't his method of study, was it?
No.
So how do we say that it unsealed it?
When you say it.
Understanding Daniel.
You mean it? No, not the it Daniel that you said, how it unsealed Daniel. What was the it? You mean Revelation 14?
Yeah.
Because he's not studying Revelation 14, that's what you're inferring.
Yeah.
He's living Revelation 14. He is Revelation 14. He is that angel. It is he, that angel, that opens the book of Daniel.
He's the angel.
Maybe I'm looking too literally, but it just kind of sounds like philosophical. I don't get it.
The philosophical.
Seeing that we have come full circle, can I get my pound of rice when I said that both angels were dealing with time?
Because you said time was no longer. Okay. Well, that's the whole point, because that's what Sister Shamila was saying. That they're the same time, which is what you were saying, and the rest of us are saying it's two different times.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So maybe we haven't bottomed it out, but we know that Daniel 11 is unsealed where?
At the time of the end.
At the time of the end. I mean, in which chapter?
What chapter? Revelation?
Yeah.
Revelation 14.
So Revelation 14 unseals Daniel 11?
Yes.
Would you agree with that? Sorry?
Early writings, William Miller. In speaking about William Miller, the servant of the Lord says, prophecies which were long darkened to the minds of the people of God were...
What was my question?
I'm answering again this with the fourth Revelation 14.
Yeah, that's fine, but what was my question?
How is it that the everlasting gospel is the Revelation 14, 6 to 12 is what opens the book of Daniel?
That wasn't my last question. What was my last question? What was my last question, Brother Jonathan?
About if this message is the same message.
My last question was, what unseals Daniel 11? That was my last question. And what's the answer?
Revelation 14.
Revelation 14 unseals it.
Well, Revelation 18.
You said it three times, it's so much more. There's no. Actually, we'll give you another option. Isn't it Revelation 18 that unseals?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
Why can't Revelation 14... Why can't Revelation 14 unseal Daniel 11? Because it was good enough to do it for 8. It was good enough to do it for Daniel 8. Why can't it do it for Daniel 11?
Is it because it's not considered present truth?
Not time. Not hinged on time.
Because it's not hinged on time?
Yes, the message is hymned on events.
You can go to many places in the scripture, in Spirit Prophecy, and she says Revelation 14 is at the end of the world.
Yes. But
she specifically says Revelation 18 is the... it's going to be in our time in terms of it's a repeat. It's a repetition of the second angel, which is Revelation 14. So Revelation 18 is repeating the second angel.
Okay, so Revelation 14 is going to unlock Daniel 8. We agree with that?
Yes.
So what's going to unlock Daniel 11?
Revelation
18. Are we sure now?
Yes.
Everybody agree with that? Brother Larry.
Maranatha. 173.6 reads, Revelation 18 points to the time when, as the result of rejecting the threefold warning of Revelation 14:6-12, the church will have fully reached the condition foretold by the second angel, and the people of God still in Babylon will be called upon to separate from their communion. So, Revelation 18 points to the time when, as the result of rejecting the threefold warning of Revelation 14, when was Revelation 14 rejected? Right there on that line. From 1798 to 1844 was the first time that that message was rejected. Amen?
Agree with that?
Yes.
So she tells us, Revelation 18 points to the time when. That would be our time. That's how I'm reading that.
Is the source correct, Maranatha, 173, or was it 178?
173.6.
Okay.
So, let me suggest this, that it's Revelation 14 that unlocks Daniel 11. But there's a problem with Revelation 14. Not the verse, not the chapter itself. There's a problem with it, or we have a problem with Revelation 14. What's the problem that we have with Revelation 14 as God's people? What have we misunderstood about Revelation 14?
Time.
Okay, so do we know 14, 9-11? Are we clear on that? Yeah? Mm-hmm. Everyone's pretty reasonably clear on that. Mm-hmm. Adventists, not just you, I mean all of us.
Mm.
Yeah? It's the mark of the beast.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? What about 14, 6 and 7? Are we all pretty clear on that? First angel's message comes in 1798. You know, an abundant amount of information on that.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm suggesting that Adventists are okay with this one and okay with this one. And what we've got a problem with is this one, Revelation 14 verse 8, which is the second angel's message.
Yeah.
There's a problem with the second angel's message that we haven't understood or comprehended. The information's there, but we just haven't been able to deal with it. What is verse 8 about? Obviously, we all know it's Babylon is fallen, but what's it talking about? What's the historical context of it?
Rejection of the church, rejection of the message.
Which church? Sorry?
It just makes sense to me that it all originated in the Catholic Church.
Okay, so Sister Lister is saying it's the Catholic Church.
I understand that Miller was preaching that it's the Adventist Church.
Sorry? Right? So some are saying Catholic and some are saying Protestant.
Which is the same thing pretty much
now.
Now?
No, but I mean now, we're not now. This is Revelation 14 verse 8.
It's not the same.
Who's this message targeted at?
The covenant people.
Sorry?
Covenant people.
This is the covenant people this is targeted at. It's not targeted at the dragon or the beast. It's aimed at God's people, isn't it?
Yeah.
This statement. Do you agree with that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Come out of all those other beliefs.
Thank you.
Sorry?
The covenant, targeting the covenant people to come out of all of those other belief systems.
No.
Mm-mm.
Okay.
The covenant keeping people that they've just gone into all of those systems. They'd already come out 42 years ago. 46 years ago.
and how does Babylon is, so Babylon is falling is now a celebratory message for them.
Who's them?
The covenant holding people.
Which ones?
It depends on what era we're talking about. Are we talking about
the Millerite covenant? History.
Okay. It's Millerite.
So I don't think it's a celebration statement. But who are they talking to when they make that?
Babylon is fallen?
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. I think they're speaking to the other church organizations.
Like whom?
Like the Catholic Church, the Protestant Church, the world.
Anyone else? Brother Jonathan?
They're just talking about Protestantism.
Yes, so let's pull up the passage that says that. Brother Larry, you got it?
It's a letter 98-1900. It's in your study Bible, the Ellen G. White study Bible.
98-1900.
Yes, sir.
Hopefully, I thought it was a GC quote, but go ahead with this one.
Okay.
It might be a GC quote.
It's a long one. I just want to give you the part that specifically speaks about Protestantism. It says, and the Protestant world has taken the child of the papacy to be regarded as sacred. In the word of God, this is called a fornication. God has a controversy with the churches of today. They are fulfilling the prophecy of John. All nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. And she goes on and tells us the churches who. So it's Protestantism.
Is there another one? Someone found it?
My device isn't working.
Came unarmed.
Do you remember
passage?
Where it was from? GC.
I know it's GC a lot.
So you can't look up.
Receiving a moral fall.
You lost. What does that mean? You lost.
I don't know.
You don't know what we're talking about.
The church is torn. It experienced a moral fall. Moral fall.
Those are the words. Moral fall.
Yes. Yep.
GC 389.
Is that what you said? 389.2. 382.
Yeah.
Not 389. I've got 389.
Yeah, I think it's the same chapter anyway.
No, it's 389.
Warning rejected.
389. The second angel's message of Revelation 14 was first preached in the summer of 1844, and it then had a more direct application to the churches of the United States. Mm-hmm. So we'll just stop there.
Yes.
GC 389, mm-hmm. paragraph 2. Mm-hmm. So it was targeted at God's people, and there's been a great misunderstanding of all of that. So here we are at the end of the world, and Revelation 14 is what's going to uncode or unseal Daniel 11. Why is that? Because Revelation 14 is the everlasting gospel. 1, 2, 3. But what does Revelation 14 need help with? It needs help with this one here.
Yeah.
Second angel's message.
Repetition.
And where's he going to receive that help, Brother Larry?
Revelation 18.
So Revelation 18 is going to help Revelation 14, which is going to unlock Daniel 11.
What do you mean by help?
Is that sort of like empowering?
If you like, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Revelation 18 is going to empower Revelation 14, which is the language that we normally use.
Mm-hmm.
The empowerment of the message. And what needs to be understood or unlocked or decoded is the second angel's message. It's this one here. The second angel's message, if you put it this way, it's the test at the end of the world. It's the test at the end of the world. And you can describe that in different ways. So we'll describe it one way. Sin. Righteousness. Okay, number two. What does that mean to be righteous? That's part of what we're discussing in our morning classes.
Right doing.
So I'm going to ask what, when, and...
How.
So if we talk about righteousness, What does it mean to be righteous? When do we become righteous? And how do we become righteous? Okay, so if I just used all of that about righteousness, what would it be dealing with? We went back to this board, it'd be dealing with this issue, wouldn't it be? Under sin, under grace.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is there a total confusion in our church about how you put away sin?
Yes.
How you deal with the sin problem?
Yes.
So, when I'm saying that 18 is going to help 14, is going to unlock this, and the problem is about the second angel, we all experience that. If I start asking you, what is the nature of man? We're not sure how it works, how it operates.
Mm-hmm.
If there's someone talks about willful sin or hidden sin,
mm-hmm.
Can we stop sinning? Can we not stop sinning? Is it our nature? Is it not our nature? Are we physical? We don't even understand all the dynamics of how to deal with this issue here. Number two step. And number two is just another way of expressing the second angel's message. Yeah? So you could describe this another way. Now we have a discussion in our movement that if this was 9/11 and this is midnight, where does the second angel's message arrive?
9/11.
So is it here? Or is it here? Or is it here? Where do you want to place it? Now, it may have escaped your attention, but now all of this is opened or open for discussion of when the second angel's message arrives. So now even in our movement, we're now discussing the rights and wrongs of where the second angel's message arrives. So there's utter confusion on what? On the second angel. Yeah? We're not understanding what the dynamics of our history is and what we're supposed to understand. I'll give another example. If you take...
That's talking about Babylon as well, and the confusion.
What is?
It's that second angel, and it's
talking about confusion, yeah. It is, because we're all confused about what's going on. So if we did this, 1840 to 1844, what would this way mark be? Oh, wait, so no, that doesn't help you. April 44. Now what is this way mark?
1842.
42, yes? So if I put May 42, what are we marking there?
The charts.
So we're marking the charts. So if this was the first, this would be the second, this would be the third, if we were going to use that as a temple cleansing.
Yes.
Yeah? Mm-hmm. So the chart, the 43 chart, becomes a symbol of the second test, second angel's message.
Yes.
Yes? Can we conceptualize that? It's nothing new. So if you zoom up on this chart here, I think we did this in class. What does the chart look like? Did we go to the back to and run through that in class?
No.
Okay, I did that somewhere else. So we'll look at the 43 chart. How's the 43 chart structured if you were going to draw it out simply? How would you do it? So I would do it this way. There's a central column. Can we see the central column here?
Yeah.
What's it listing?
Chronology.
It's all chronology, all dates. Yeah? And Ellen White would describe that as what? The chain?
Truth.
Chain of truth.
Truth.
With the links.
Yeah.
So all that's on this side is what? It's just figures that line up with these dates.
Yes.
With animals, and they all line up.
Mm.
Then you've got some calculations up here, and then again you've got some more figures down here. But all of these figures are all lining up with these dates. So the structure is here, you've got this central column. And what is this central column? What is that central column?
2520.
The 2520. If you look on the chart, you'll see it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? So both charts are structured the same way. This one is actually boxed in. Same central column, they both take you to the same place from 677 to 1844, 1843. They structured exactly the same way, did the same chart. But what was this chart a vision of, or a fulfillment of, sorry? This is Habakkuk 2. And Habakkuk 2 is what? What does it say? Make the vision plain on tables. So what vision is being made plain here? What vision is being made plain here? It's the 2520. The chart is the 2520. Everything else is just links in the chain. The chart, both charts, are the 2520. So now you know in 1863 why they have to replace the charts. When they get rid of the 2520, you have to get rid of those charts because the charts are the 2520.
Amen.
Yeah? And you can see in when it talks about Habakkuk chapter 2, so we haven't done his class, so you might not know. Where is Habakkuk?
In the Bible?
He's a watchman.
In real life, in history, where is he? Right? No, where is he? We've got to use the historical critical methodology. Don't tell them that we do that in class. We'll get into trouble. Here's a timeline. Here's Habakkuk. And Zephaniah is just afterwards. There's no point looking in your Bible. No, your answer is in your study Bible.
For the historical.
Sorry?
My Bible gives me. You're talking about the time.
Yeah, I want us to know if we've got working knowledge.
Where it's placed.
Where is he? Where you know these chronological big tables? It tells you where all the prophets are in Revelation.
That's what I'm going to remember.
Sorry?
Before Joel.
No. So you think he's before Joel? What year is Joel?
900. I don't know.
Three?
Sorry, no.
Yeah.
After Joel.
No. Joel is 721. We've been able to prove that recently.
Habakkuk is
during the reign of Manasseh.
Okay, so Habakkuk and Zephaniah are just after Manasseh and before Josiah.
Yes. During the first part of Josiah's reign.
Okay, Habakkuk can't be before part of Josiah, even though people say that in their comment, because you're in the commentary on that.
Yes.
Because if you look at his language and what he's saying,
he's before Manasseh.
He's after Manasseh, because Manasseh would have killed him if he had been around then.
Yeah.
And he's a little bit before or around the same time as Josiah. He's in between these two.
Okay.
But Ammon only reigns for 2 years, and Habakkuk's probably around for longer. So all I'm saying is, he's around this time period here, and what's he saying? What's God telling him? What is the vision that he has to write?
The 2520 that Babylon is coming.
When?
No.
677.
No, 677 is back here.
607.
It's here with Zedekiah, isn't it? Isn't this the vision that he's talking about? It says, write this vision about the destruction in Zedekiah's reign.
Yes.
Yeah?
So that's 587, 586.
Yeah, 586, whatever date we put it, but it's this one that he's pointing to.
Yes.
So the 2520 is dealing with what? The destruction of God's people, isn't it?
Yes.
So we take this and bring it here and bring it into our own time. So now you begin to see why you want to reject these charts. Why do you want to reject these charts? Because what are the charts telling you?
Talking about the destruction of the SDA church.
Talking about the destruction of the SDA church. And we want to bury that information, so we don't want these charts around. So, this chart is the second angel, similar to the second angel. We've got this whole issue about righteousness, which nobody seems to understand. What else did we look at? We're not sure about who actually is being called out and targeted here when it talks about the second angel in Millerite history. There's many things we don't understand about it. And the other thing we don't understand about the second angel, the most important one, is this, I think, for us probably. Here's 1844. What's this?
Third angel.
Third angel. Yeah, everybody can see that?
Yeah.
Third angel's message. When does the third angel's message do its work? What would this waymark be? Sunday law. Yeah? Where does Ellen White put 18 verse 2?
Before the Sunday law.
Sorry?
I think before the Sunday law.
No, she puts it. She puts it right here at the Sunday law.
18:3.
18:2 and 3.
Oh, it's 3. It's
what 3?
18:3 is the Sunday law. 18:4 is the Sunday law, sorry.
And I'm not asking what you think. I'm asking you where Ellen White will place it. If we go to Revelation, if we go to Great Controversy, I think chapter 37, 38 talks about the loud cry of the third angel. When is the loud cry of the third angel? The Sunday law,
yes.
Isn't it? So here's the Sunday law. It's the loud cry of the third angel. The loud cry of the third angel is when it gets empowered, when Babylon falls. Babylon falls at the Sunday law. Yeah, yes. It's all complete by then. So she's going to bring you here. But we say, so this is number two, second angel. Babylon is fallen. But we bring it here at 9/11. So, you know, however you approached it over and over again, the problem with the gospel message, with understanding Daniel, is all tied into the second angel. There was a misunderstanding about the second angel in Millerite history. There's a misunderstanding about the second angel in our history. And Revelation 14 is the everlasting gospel. Then to unlock Daniel 11, you need Revelation 18 to be clearly understood, which is going to empower Revelation 14, as Sister Shamila said, will empower Revelation 14, because Revelation 14 is going to decode or unlock Daniel 11. That's why we need Revelation 18. And it's all about the second angel. That's why in Revelation 18 it says the second angel.
So at 9/11, were any of these verses in Revelation 18 fulfilled?
Depends who you ask. Because there's so much confusion on this subject. If you ask people where you place verse 4, ask any Adventist, where would they tell you? Come out for my people. I mean, there's unanimity on that. There's no argument about verse 4. The argument is where you put verses 1, 2 and 3. That's where the argument is.
Yeah.
Because that's where the confusion is, because there's not an understanding of the second angel.
But why?
I don't know why.
In the commentary it says that that God used the Chaldeans in Habakkuk's tables. God used the Chaldeans to essentially punish the saints. Who would the Chaldeans be in our timeline?
Okay, so that's Habakkuk chapter 1 verse 5. Okay. That bitter and hasty people. This was Babylon. The Chaldeans are Babylon. Okay. The Babylonians. That's Nebuchadnezzar it's referring to. So who's Babylon at the end of the world? Yeah? We're going to use Rome to come and destroy us. We've run out of time.
I guess that's where I was lumping everybody in with Catholics, if you're a Sunday worshiper. You're Catholic.
So before we pray, and with your assignments, I've read them all. They're all reasonably good. We've had some discussion. Maybe you've got a little bit of opportunity to revamp them or hand them in if you haven't handed them in yet. And we'll pick the study up again on Wednesday. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness and mercy. We ask and pray that you would be with us and guide us. Lord, help us to have much greater clarity on the work of these angels and what they mean to us individually and as a group. We ask for your blessing, Father, in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.